Hello everyone, I'm Hao Tianzhang from Stanford University. I will present our work, vid2player, Controllable Video Sprites that Behave and Appear Like Professional Tennis Players. These days, videos of professional sporting events, like these videos of Wimbledon, are widely available on the internet. Meanwhile, it is also possible to annotate these videos with off-the-shelf computer vision models, such as human segmentation, post key points, and chord lines. In this paper, we are interested in the question, can we take all these videos, along with machine and human-generated annotations, and use them to synthesize interactively controllable video spreads of star tennis players? Here is an example result from our system. This video, featuring stars Roger Federer and Novak Djokovic playing a competitive point, may look like a real broadcast tennis video, but it is actually completely generated by our system. The stars both look and behave like their real-life counterparts. We can also create matchups that have never been seen before, such as Roger Federer playing against himself at Wimbledon, or even against Serena Williams. Our system also allows the user to interactively control star tennis players. Here the user is controlling Djokovic in the near court. The red dot illustrates where Djokovic should hit the ball, and the blue box specifies his court positioning after each shot. We can also modify real-life points to visualize different outcomes. For example, in the 2019 Wimbledon final, Federer famously missed this forehand that would have won him the championship. We can modify the point to show that what might have been had Federer hit the ball a little to the left. Our goal is to create virtual characters that look, move, and behave in simulated points like star tennis players. To achieve this, our work makes the following contributions. First, we use domain knowledge to design a racket sport-specific state machine that is used to control and synthesize our video sprites. Second, inspired by the field of sport analytics, we build player-specific data-driven behavior models that predict a player's shot selection and court positioning decisions, which are used as control inputs for the state machine. Third, we provide methods for preparing a large database of real-world broadcast footage for use in a rendering system based on controllable video textures. Before digging into our method, I need to provide you some background knowledge of tennis. A tennis match is divided into points, where each point starts with a serve, continues with alternative shots between the two players, and ends with one player hitting a winner shot or an error shot. A point can be further broken down into shot cycles. In a shot cycle, a player first moves to the incoming ball, makes ball contact, and hits the ball to a specific location shown in red. Note that also after the ball contact, the player recovers to a new position on the court to prepare for the next shot shown in blue. Let's see this one more time. In each shot cycle, a player must make two decisions, where to place the shot and where to recover to. The shot cycle state machine repeats for each of the two players over and over until the point ends. Also note that when one player is in the reaction phase, the other player is in the recovery phase. We use the structure provided by our shot cycle state machine to synthesize novel points from real-world footage. Starting with unannotated broadcast tennis videos, we first extract the shot cycle clips and organize them into a database. To make our tennis players behave like real-world players, we build player-specific behavior models from the database examples. These models predict shot selection and player recovery position goals. Next, we select the shot cycle clip where the player best meets desired behavior goals. Finally, to make the synthesized tennis players look realistic, we manipulate these video clips to ensure visual continuity, such as adjusting lighting conditions. The result of this process, repeated for multiple shot cycles, is a synthesized novel point. To extract shot cycle structure from a collection of broadcast videos, we combine human and machine annotations to label both shot level information and perform player detections. We use human annotation to identify precisely when and where shots occur, the types of the shot, such as forehand or backhand, topspin or slice, as well as the shot outcome. We use automatic techniques to extract per-frame player positions, segmentations, pose key points, and estimate the broadcast camera extrinsics from courtline detections. This offline annotation process creates a database of shot cycle clips for 4 male players and 2 female players in both Wimbledon and US Open, where each player has at most a few hundred clips. At the time of this project, it took about 1 human hour to annotate 1 hour of wall clock broadcast footage. These human annotation costs could be significantly reduced with the use of more advanced video analysis tools. Using our database of shot cycle clips, we construct player behavior models that predict what a player will do in a given point situation. Consider a situation where the player in the far court has just hit the ball, as shown here. This also marks the start of the shot cycle for the near player. Given the incoming ball's trajectory and the positions of the two players, the goal of the behavior model is to predict what shot the near player will hit in this shot cycle, including the shot's type, court placement, and velocity, as well as predict where the player will recover to at the end of the cycle. To make these behavior decisions, we build a point state descriptor with the following features: the start and bounce positions of the incoming ball, predicted position of the player when they get to the ball, as well as their opponent's position. To reduce the dimension of this point state space, we discretize each side of the court into 6 regions. For example, the blue and purple boxes show the regions containing the near player and his opponent. We also include the player's velocity during the reaction phase as an input feature, since a player's shot choices depend on whether they are in good position to hit the shot or need to chase down the incoming ball. Given the descriptor for the current point, we find all database clips with a similar descriptor and build kernel density estimators to model distributions of player behavior. In this example, the distribution of the near player's shot placement is shown in orange. The recovery position distribution is shown in blue. At runtime, we sample the two distributions to obtain the player's target shot placement position and recovery position for the upcoming shot cycle. Here are behavior distributions and sample targets for a few shot cycles in our generated point. To synthesize video sprites for a player, our system must find database shot cycle clips that best match desired behavior goals. Let's go back to this moment when the player on the far court has just hit the ball, and the behavior model has just generated shot selection and recovery position goals for the near player. Now it is time to search for the next shot cycle clip for the near player. Given this point state, there could be many candidate clips for the next shot cycle. For example, here we show 3 candidates, where the player moves to hit the incoming ball at different points along its trajectory. To select the best shot cycle clip, we use a cost metric with the following terms. First, to preserve animation continuity at the transition point, we assign cost to differences in pose and pose velocity between the last pose of the previous shot cycle and the initial pose of the candidate clip. Next, to measure how well the player intersects the incoming ball, we add cost based on the difference between the ball's position at the estimated contact time and the contact position of the candidate clip. We also add cost based on how well the player's final position in the candidate clip matches the recovery position constraint. Finally, to encourage the swing motion in the candidate clip to be consistent with the player's shot placement goal, we will then cast two difference in the target shot placement position and the placement of the shot in the candidate clip. Summation of these terms yields the overall cost metric for clip search. With the next shot cycle clip selected, we render the clip into a final animation using the idea of video textures. Given a background image of an empty court, the chosen shot cycle clip and transformation parameters such as translation and scale, we composite the player sprite to the target location using the player mat extracted from the original footage. Here is the result after composition. We also generate player shadows to increase realism. In order to use controllable video textures with real-world footage, we have to tackle a few challenges. One challenge involves lighting differences across time. Here are example frames from a single 5-hour long match. You can see that the lighting and shading changes significantly over the duration of the match. Here is another example, where Serena Williams wears different clothing on two different match days. Note that she only has a long-sleeved shirt on the second day. Directly stitching these clips together yields jarring visual discontinuities. Note the lighting discontinuities on top and the clothing appearance discontinuities on the bottom. To address changes in lighting, we use unpaired image-to-image translation to map the non-uniform source lighting distribution into a uniform target lighting distribution. We define the uniform lighting target distribution by selecting a collection of images from a short window of time in one match day. Here is the result of normalizing the lighting in frames from the source distribution. To see it one more time, this is before normalization and this is after normalization. Note that this normalization can be performed offline as a pre-processing step. It does not impact runtime performance. Here we show the unnormalized result with lighting differences on the top and the normalized result on the bottom, where the differences have been corrected. We apply the same unpaired image-to-image transfer technique to address Serena Williams' clothing differences across days. Here are the normalized results. Note that Serena is now wearing the long-sleeved top in all frames. To see it one more time, this is before normalization, and this is after normalization. Again, the unnormalized result is shown on the top, and the normalized result shown on the bottom. Another challenge of working with broadcast footage is that the near-side player's lower body is often cropped to the bottom of the screen. Artifacts result when cropped input clips are rendered to novel court locations during point generation. To address this issue, we hallucinate cropped body regions using a two-step algorithm. First, we complete missing parts of the cropped player's 2D skeleton by finding complete skeletons in the database with a similar upper body pose. We then apply paired image-to-image translation to generate player pixels from the skeleton images. Finally, we compose the hallucinated lower body pixels with the original upper body to obtain the completed player sprite. Here is a comparison before and after the completion. Just as a reminder, body completion is also an offline pre-processing step. To assess the quality of our results, we simulate hundreds of random points between different players and evaluate them both qualitatively by visual inspection and quantitatively through a user study conducted by expert tennis players. For the qualitative evaluation, we observe that our behavior models capture common tennis strategies, such as a player hitting more shots to their opponent's weaker side. In this example, Djokovic, in the near court, prefers to hit the ball to Federer's backhand, so he directs more of his shots to the right side of the court. Against Nadal, a left-handed player, Djokovic is more likely to hit to the left side of the court, again targeting Nadal's backhand side. As another example, when a player has to chase down an incoming ball, our behavior models commonly generate lower risk cross court shots. These easier shots are typical of defensive tennis play. However, when a player is already well positioned to hit an incoming ball, our behavior models encourage more aggressive play, such as hitting the ball to the open part of the court. As a final example, when our behavior models direct the player into the net, they do so most often after a down-the-line shot. Approaching the net following a down-the-line shot is a well-known tennis strategy. Our behavior models also capture player-specific styles. For example, Nadal tends to recover to positions further back in the court, on average about 2 meters behind the baseline. In contrast, Federer prefers to stand 1 meter closer to the baseline, ready to attack if the opportunity arises. We also conduct an ablation study, where we remove the behavior models and choose clips based on only visual continuity and ball contact goals. Without the behavior models, our system often does not generate plausible motion. In this example, Nadal, in the near court, performs the unlikely action of hitting a backhand from the far left side of the court and fails to recover towards the court center, allowing Federer to win the point easily. In contrast, when using behavior models to set goals, Nadal hits a more likely shot, a forehand. He then returns to center in anticipation of Federer's next shot. In this example, note how Djokovic, in the near court, keeps hitting the ball back to Federer and moves further and further outside the court. In the same situation, the behavior model causes Djokovic to hit a winner into the wide open court. We also conducted a user study involving collegiate tennis players. Our participants judged that videos generated with our behavior models were more realistic than the ones generated without behavior models. We have also generated novel points from US Open footage. Here is a matchup between Nadal and Federer, who surprisingly have never played each other in real life at the US Open. Here, tennis legend Serena Williams competes against the young-up and coming star Coco Gauff, a highly anticipated matchup that also has never occurred at the US Open. Although our system generates very realistic video spreads, visual artifacts still remain in our results. Our output can exhibit errors due to imperfect annotation, such as inaccurate player segmentation or inaccurate racket segmentation due to motion blur. However, we believe increasingly accurate computer vision models stand to reduce these artifacts, as well as make the majority of our data annotation pipeline fully automatic. Our results also display well-known artifacts of video textures, such as player fruit skate and discontinuity at clip transitions, which occur when our clip database lacks good matches. We are interested in exploring the latest neural rendering and neural motion synthesis techniques to address these issues. Lighting normalization can fail under drastically different lighting conditions, which may be improved by application of more advanced image harmonization techniques. Finally, I want to conclude this talk with the two takeaways. First, our system is largely data-driven, but it benefits significantly from injecting domain knowledge of tennis into our model's data. Specifically, we use the short cycle state machine to structure the model and use learning to obtain critical behavior distributions from the data. Although we have only evaluated the short cycle state machine in the context of tennis, we believe it will generalize to other racket sports as well. It is also interesting to think about how we can create or potentially learn state machines in other multiplayer sports scenarios. Secondly, we are excited by the content creation potential of creating rich human characters from watching videos of people performing complex activities. The key question is, of course, how to model the complex range of human appearance and behaviors captured by video observations. We believe this is an interesting question for both the graphics community and the machine learning community. Thank you.